Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. In this video, I'm going to do an introduction to serology. Let's start with some definitions. So immunology is a study of the immune system, or how the body defends itself against non-self substances, which generally is pathogens. Serology is a division of immunology that specializes in the lab detection and the measurement of specific antibodies that develop in the blood during a response to the exposure to a disease-producing antigen. So it's a way to look at how the body defends itself. What's the evidence of the body defending itself against a pathogen or a non-self substance? And in serology, we look at the detection of the antibodies, but we also can look at the detection of the antigen. So what is an antigen? An antigen is a substance that stimulates antibody formation and has the ability to bind to that antibody. It can be so many things. It can definitely be pathogens, but it can also be markers on foreign cells. And antigens can even be things that are harmless, like pollen or like food substances, like gluten or dairy or peanuts or strawberries or something like that. All right, so cellular antigens of importance in immunology are going to be your major histocompatibility complex tissue antigens. So those are your MHC antigens. They are also known as the human leukocyte antigens or HLA antigens. Also your autoantigens. So this is what your immune system looks at to detect self versus non-self. And the blood group antigens. So this is the ABO, Rh, and then all the other blood groups. In most cases, the normal immune system will respond to foreign antigens by producing antibodies, and then those antibodies can be found in plasma and other body fluids that we can then test. So let's talk about serology and this antigen antibodies and how we use all of that. So a foreign antigenic substance is going to be recognized by lymphocytes and plasma cells, and their reaction to it is going to be the formation of antibodies. So if an antibody has been formed against a foreign antigenic substance, then a good way to see if the infective organism was present is to find the antibody in the patient's serum or in the patient's plasma. So this is the basis for immunologic and serologic determinations. This is especially true for things that aren't easily cultured. So we can get samples and culture bacteria pretty easily. We can even culture yeast pretty easily, but we don't culture viruses. We can culture them, they're just a little harder to culture. So your average clinical lab is not gonna culture a virus. And so the way we would detect either a virus or a bacteria that's hard to culture then is going to be look for the formation of the antibodies against that bacteria against that virus or that bacteria that's hard to culture or that pathogen. And so this is the basis for the immunological and serological determinations that we do. So if a known antigen is combined with a patient's serum that contains antibodies against that specific antigen, then you will see a reaction. And if that antibody then is not present in the patient's serum, then no reaction will be observed. So this is illustrated in this HIV test. So this is a quick screening test, and it's looking for the presence of the anti-HIV antibodies in a patient's serum. And I don't know if you can see, but there's C for control line. So the control line is present all the way across, but then there's no line, no reaction under the 1 and 2. So this is looking for HIV-1 and HIV-2 antibodies. And there aren't any detected there. So these two are negative. And then in this one, you can see a line under the 1. So that means that this sample here is positive for anti-HIV-1 antibodies. And then this one here, you can see it too faintly, positive for anti-HIV-1. None of these are positive for anti-HIV-2. Okay, so this is an illustration of using, trying to look for the presence of the antibodies to detect exposure to the virus. Okay, some tests, for example, like the flu test illustrated below here, they look for the antigen directly. So you get a nose swab for the flu, and if the flu virus is present in your secretions in the nose, then it will be detected in this test using anti-flu antibodies as part of the reagents. So in this little illustration here, you can see that this one is positive for flu A and that one's positive for flu B. And so this is a direct determination from a sample. So let's talk a little bit more on antigen and antibodies. An antigen is generally described as a substance that, when injected into an animal, is going to be recognized as foreign. And if the immunologically active cells are present, so the immune system is working, you have lymphocytes, you have macrophages, monocytes, all of them are present, then there will be an immune reaction or an immune response to that particular antigen. So this immune response is usually the production of antibodies, and antibodies are molecules that usually protect the body against those foreign antigens, the pathogens, etc. So antibodies, they are proteins that are produced in response to a foreign antigenic stimuli. They are produced by B cells, B lymphocytes, that once they get triggered into antibody production, they become plasma cells. And antibodies are also known as immunoglobulins, or IG. And this is because, they're known as gamma globulins. And this is because when you do a protein electrophoresis of serum, they are several regions and they name them. So we have the albumin spike, and then you have alpha, gamma, and delta, alpha, beta, and then gamma. And so they are in the gamma region, which is the last region. And the gamma region has all the antibodies there. And so this is, you know, only seen on seromoplasma electrophoresis. So then we call them gamma globulins, immunoglobulins, antibodies. Those are all interchangeable. They all mean the same thing. There are five classes of immunoglobulin antibodies with different molecular weights and different biological activity. So there are IgM. So IgM is the first to rise when confronted with a foreign antigen. IgM is also part of your innate immune system. So there's some innate IgM that's protective. Only 6% of the antibodies in plasma are going to be IgM. And so they're really important. IgG is the most predominant. So 80% of the immunoglobulin is going to be IgG. When we're testing, for example, for that HIV antibody, we're testing for IgG. So IgG antibodies are made specifically to a foreign antigen, and they are found in greater number than IgM, but it also found later in the response than IgM. IgA is the next one, and this one is fine in secretion. So wherever you find mucus, if you have a good immune system response, you can find IgA. And it's about 13% of immunoglobulins that are floating around in your blood. And so again, it's protective in the secretions. Then we have IgD. This immunoglobulin is found on the surface of lymphocytes, and it's only 1% of the immunoglobulins found in the blood. And then IgE is usually less than 1%. And it's an immunoglobulin that gets produced during allergic reactions. So if you were to be allergic to peanuts or allergic to bee stings, the antibody that will be sensitized to produce that antibody is going to be an IgE class antibody against bee sting venom or against peanut proteins. The antibodies themselves all have a similar chemical structural configuration. They have this little Y configuration illustrated here. So it's usually a monomer composed of two identical heavy chains. They're in light blue here, the heavy chains, and then two identical light chains. They're here in the orange. The tail end of the Y is a constant region, so it doesn't vary. And then the both hands of the Y, the top here, are the variable regions, and this is what makes the antibody specific to a virus or specific to a bacteria, and again within that a specific virus or specific bacteria. And So this is a good illustration of what IgG looks like. IgE is very similar, except the heavy chain is slightly longer. IgA is like two of these put together tail to tail. So flip this one upside down and attach it, and you have IgA. And then IgM is five of these linked tail to tail, and it makes it like a snowflake kind of configuration. So environmentally stimulated antibodies, sometimes called natural antibodies, and they're usually IgM, they appear to exist without intentional immunogenic stimulus. They're just there to protect you. Example of those are going to be the anti-A and anti-B antibodies found in the ABO blood group system. In contrast, immune antibodies are the result of stimulation by a specific foreign antigen, and they are usually the IgG class, and they are referred to as unexpected antibodies, and, you know, again, are the result of specific antigenic stimulation. So, for example, if you never had strep throat in your entire life, you would not have antibodies to strep pyogenes because you just never got exposed to it. And so as you test for antibodies in somebody, you can kind of get a repertoire of all the diseases that they have been exposed to. So let's talk about how these antibodies are produced. So again, first of all, they are produced by lymphocytes. And when the lymphocytes, the B lymphocytes, are stimulated to turn into plasma cells, which become little antibody factories. So they do require about 2 weeks to develop sufficiently, so to get stimulated and then to enter into full antibody production. And then once they have been, you know, fully turned on and they're making a lot of antibodies, then at that point they can elicit an effective, what we call secondary antigen antibody response, and that gives you protection. So that means it's so effective as a response that you have no symptoms if your body runs across the antigen again. The primary response is when the foreign antigen is first introduced, and the antibody cannot be detected until about 10 to 14 days after that stimulation. And then the concentration of the antibody, also referred to as the antibody titer, will be the greatest at about 20 days after exposure, after which it will gradually go down. The subclass of antibody associated with that primary response is going to be IgM. So IgM is always the first to be detected. If you detect elevated IgM after exposure to, or suspected exposure to, a pathogen, that means this is a new pathogen. It's just, you know, the body just encountered it and it's mounting its primary response. The secondary response is the anamnestic response. Anamnestic mean an, not amnesia, not forget, meaning the immune system did not forget the exposure. And but this time it's going to produce IgG class. So the memory response is always IgG. And that secondary response will occur faster and last longer, and will consist mostly of IgG class, although you can get some IgM response also. And the antibody concentrations are going to reach a higher titer, so high here that often you don't even know that you know, you've been exposed, because your body just squashes that pathogen very effectively. So this is also the fact that we have a primary immune response and then a very strong secondary immune response after exposure to an antigen is the basis of vaccines. So vaccines trigger this primary immune response right here, in hopes that if you are exposed to the pathogen in real life, you just get this secondary immune response here and you just actually never develop symptoms and you're not sick. This can also be the reason behind booster shots. They are trying to actually trigger that secondary immune response to make sure that everything is still functioning immune system still remembers and still has cells around that can produce those antibodies. A few more definitions. So a non-covalent bonding of the antigen with its respective specific antibody is called an immune complex. So let's say a flu virus with an anti-flu antibody linked together would be an immune complex. Monoclonal antibodies are purified antibodies that are cloned from a single cell, a single lymphocyte, a single plasma cell, if you will, and they are pure and very specific. And so they can recognize and bind a specific antigen, and therefore that makes them really useful for testing because it gives good diagnostic precision, and there can also be used for cancer therapy. So this is, the principle behind this is that when a lymphocyte gets triggered against a specific antigen, so let's pick a virus, let's pick flu A, for example, of a certain strain, because flu does mutate, okay, so that's why sometimes we can lose immunity against the flu, because it changes and mutates. But let's say, the flu strain this year, plasma cell that's been triggered to produce antibodies against that flu A strain of this year, that is the only antibody it will ever produce. It will not produce anything else. It will not produce antibodies to strep, and it will not produce antibodies to RSV or anything like that. It will only ever produce that type of flu A antibody for this particular year's strain. So if you can isolate that plasma cell and get it to produce antibodies, all the antibodies that it produces are going to be identical to each other, and they're going to be very specific for that specific flu test. So that it's just an illustration, just so you get the idea of monoclonal antisera. And then polyclonal antibodies are usually produced by immunizing an animal with the antigen that's being studied and then isolating and purifying the antibody from the animal's serum. But this means that it's actually a variety of antibodies, and so they're heterogeneous, and so they do not have the specificity of monoclonal antibodies and are more likely to cross-react. And then lastly, we have complements. So it is a heat labile series of 18 plasma proteins that are floating around that can be activated. And so when an antigen and its matching antibody join together, then they activate the classic complement pathway. And those proteins, once they're activated, they trigger each other in a cascade. And what it does is they assemble together in a membrane attack complex that can disrupt cellular membranes. So, of course, this is only useful for pathogens that have a cell membrane, such as bacteria, protozoans, and yeast, for example, but it would not be as useful against a virus, because the virus does not have a cell membrane, because it's not a cell. And so there you go. This is complement. It is part of our immune system and our defense, and we can detect complement also in the blood, and it can be part of serology testing. So anyway, so this is a good intro here to serology testing. I have more to come on the body's defense system and then on specific serological testing. So I'll see you there. Thanks.